Hey guys, welcome to the third of the lecture series on farm animal production and health. The first one was, I'm sorry, not production and health, farm animal production, right? Which is ruminant production. So the first one was on the overview of the livestock sector with the role of the veterinarian. Second one was agroecological zones. And third one I'm going to call, you know, towards self-sufficiency in dairy products. Right, so it's actually an old slide from 2016. So I've done you more recent ones than this in my first lectures. I read this basically from the, you know, central bank document, right, which shows the key socio-economic indicators. See, from 2008 to 2016, you see the contribution of agriculture sector is 7% of the whole GDP, and out of the agricultural GDP, which is this, you know, 641,000 million, so that's like 641 million for agriculture. Out of that, animal production is this, see, about 1/10. Here it's about, I don't know, 1/8, 1/9, right? But on the 2018 data, it's approximately 1/10, right? So I'm sorry, this is about 1/12, right? 1/12 or 1/13, but in 2018 data, it's about 1/10. So that's how the agriculture contribution was 7%, livestock contribution was 10% out of the agriculture. So the overall overall contribution from animal production came as 0.7%, right, for 2018 data. But here it's slightly less, but that's not important. You have to know the 2018 data, not 2016, or you might even have to know 2019 or 20. By the time you write the exam, right, latest date by the exam. Okay, so this is the GDP share of agriculture, right? So from 1960 to 2016, look at how it has evolved. See, it has been as right up there, 30% in 1960, and then down to, you know, the 7% you saw earlier, right? So from about 2010 onwards, it has been down here, right? So what do you think? Do you think that's a good thing? Do you think this is expected, or do you think this is abnormal, right? Hope you've already answered this question on the quiz. Right, so this may not necessarily mean that the agriculture sector has gone down. Rather, what it shows is that the rest of the economy has gone up. The technical aspect, industrial aspect, services, right? So when those go up in relation to those, agriculture looks smaller, right? But if you look at the, maybe the absolute value, right? So the absolute value, it might be the same of agriculture, right? So like, you know, say if it was 100 million, for example, so it might have been 100 million in 2016 as well as in 1960, right? But the rest, the total was only 300 million here, right? So 100 million is approximately 30% out of 300 million, right? But now the other ones have developed. So agriculture is still worth 100 million, but the total is now like, you know, 1,300 million. Now that makes it, the value of agriculture compared to the rest, just 7%, right? So something like that. So this is a pattern you expect to see, right? Doesn't mean agriculture contribution has gone down, absolute value, but in relation to the other development, right? Agriculture contribution to the national GDP goes down. This has happened throughout the world if you look at the economy, right? Okay, so I hope that's clear to everybody. Right, so this shows, you know, we talked about the number of farms on the first lecture. You might recall that we said about, you know, 600,000 total farms, including, you know, livestock and poultry, right? So this here comes to, should add up to the about the same, right? 330,000 plus 150, 480, 510, 590, you know, 600,000 plus farms, right? Together. So those are the two numbers you need to remember. You know, approximately 600,000 farms altogether, and, you know, 300 odd cattle farm, right? So together, 350,000 cattle farm, cattle and buffalo farm, right? Which means, you know, there are the same numbers of farmers and employees more than that, right? So out of these 330,000 cattle farms, you know, it's unsurprisingly the maximum highest commonest type of farms are semi-intensive, and about 30% extensive. You know, that's what you saw, that's what we saw in the dry zone, right? Dry zone, low country. What's interesting here is, though, that the fact that it says there are 15% intensive farms, intensively managed farms, right? So I don't know how accurate that is, because, you know, like I said, for it to be considered 100% intensive, there cannot be any grazing or, you know, at all. It has to be 100% cut and fed, right? So sometimes even more than the large farms, there are small farms like this, right? In and around central province, right? Even western province, they don't send them grazing, or, you know, because there's no grazing land for them to send them, right? So they essentially have to bring everything to the animals, right? But that doesn't mean just because it's 100% cut and fed, all the other facilities are there to match the intensive definition, right? It has to be high tech when you say intensive. Okay, so anyway, you need to know these numbers, because these are the numbers that have been published by the Department of Animal Production and Health. So we have no option but to believe that all this is accurate, right? So they might be slightly off by a few percentages, but they are mostly accurate. So I have already uploaded some references, right? So mainly the livestock statistical bulletin, and then the national livestock statistical data of the government, right? So those two websites I have uploaded. Right, so this shows the breakdown of the different groups of cattle, right? So during our first lecture, we said we have something around 1.4 million cattle total population, right? So this is cattle, this is buffalo, right? So about 0.4 million buffalo, 0.4 million or 400,000 buffalo, and 1.4 million cattle, right? So right, so you need to know the different numbers, right? Now if you say, you know, I ask you a question, you know, typical population, if you look at the human population, you have 1-to-1 ratio approximately of male to female, right? But that's not the case here. See, male animals, it's like 260,000, right? So only 260,000 of the total cattle population are males, right? See, out of 1.4 million, only 260,000, right? So which is about 1/5 are males and 80% females, all these females, cows and young female animals. So that doesn't mean when they are born it's not 1-to-1 ratio, but it's simply because, you know, male animals have limited to no value for the dairy industry. Therefore, male animals have to be culled right from the beginning, right? So, you know, within a matter of weeks from birth, male animals are typically sent to the slaughterhouse, male calves. Right? So that's why you see this large disproportion between male to female, right? And so you need to know right now when we say, so remember cattle, you know, we also say neat cattle, neat cattle, elaharak, it's a direct translation, neat cattle, elaharak, right? But you know, when we say cattle, it's cattle. Buffalo is not cattle, right? Buffalo is a different genus, right? So when we say cattle, it's elaharak. You don't have to say neat cattle. So out of the 400,000, you know, 400,000, 400 million liters, at least 400 million liters produced by cattle. Now you see, you know, I said so 260,000 male animals, which is about, which leaves about 11.5 lakhs of females. However, you see only 400,000, only 400,000 of that 11.5 lakhs, right, 1.1 million is milking, are being milked, right? 400,000 animals are being milked. So it is this 400,000 animals that produce 400 million liters of milk a year, right? So years per year. And so if you want to look at the average production, you have to take the 400 million liters from here, right? So 400 million liters from here, and then, you know, you divide that by 365 to get the daily production, right? So this is the annual production, divide by 365, you get the daily production. And then you divide that by 400,000 cattle, 398,000 cattle. So this gives you the average production per cow per day, right? So the average is very low, very embarrassing, you might even say, to say that, you know, Sri Lanka's national average production is only 2.8 liters per cow per day, right? So you could look at it in different ways. You know, you could say that 400,000 animals are producing 400 million liters, or you can even say, you know, so all these are, you know, animal, cows, female animals, right? So look at what the asterisk says, milking animals, milking at present, two asterisks, not milking, dry at present, right? So, you know, in animals, cows don't produce milk all 12 months of the year. I mean, you can get them to produce milk, but, you know, eventually they will dry out and it's not good for their long-term physiology. So what we typically do is, we typically get milk 10 months of the year, and 2 months of the year we dry them off, right? So this, that's what this means, right? So not milking animals, so large proportion. So ideally the ratio here should be 8-to-2. If there are 8 milking animals, non-milking animals should be 2, but here the ratio is very different, right? So almost like, you know, 8-to-5, when it should actually be 8-to-2. Okay, so that's not a good thing, that's a bad thing, right? So you have 250,000 animals that are dry, so these are potentially, they are milkable, right? If you, you know, if you do improve management, you know, this number will go down, right? that number can be brought down. And so if you add these together, because they also, you know, always, you know, potential milking animals, right? So you get this number, 642,000. So if you divide that number by 365 and 642,000, you get even worse number than the previous 2.8. You get 1.7 liters per cow per day, right? So, you know, depending on how you want to define Sri Lanka's average production, it can be either 2.8 or 1.7, which is very bad. And so these data from 2017, right? So I want you to, at the time of making these lecture notes, the 2018 data were not out, right? So you can access the 2018 data. I have given you the link on the website, right? So there is also a dairy bulletin. Dairy bulletin I have already uploaded that has 2018 data, right? Numbers are not largely different, very similar, right? So you also need to look at the buffalo population, because buffalo also give about 1/5 of Sri Lanka's total milk production, right? So 400,000 and 80,000, right? So that's nearly 1/5, 1/6, something like that, right? Buffalo production. And so you need to be familiar with these numbers. Huh? So if at a Viva or MCQ question, I ask you, what is the annual milk production of cattle in Sri Lanka? Don't give this number. That is cattle plus buffalo, right? But if I ask you, what is the total milk production in Sri Lanka? Then that's this number. That's a total milk. But if I ask you, what is the cattle milk production? That's this number. So you need to be aware of those. Right? So if I ask you, what is the, milking population in Sri Lanka? Right? So if I ask you, what is the milking population in Sri Lanka? That's these two numbers together. Right? That's these two numbers, because both are being milked, 425,000. Now, I won't ask you, 525,000. I won't ask you exact numbers, but I'll give you an MCQ. So you'll have to choose the closest one, right? Something like that. So you need to be thorough with these numbers, okay? And this group, other cows, 3*, see that is, that says, infertile or aged cows. Now, in Western countries, when cows get older, right, their production capacity goes down. They can't produce milk or calves, right? So we call it getting rid of the animals. We call them culling, right? Cull, C-U-L-L, cull animals. And so now this cull is not like releasing the animal into a field, you know, it's essentially slaughtering cows, right? So when you have to, so Sri Lanka being a Buddhist country and, you know, the Eastern perception, we are not very slaughter friendly. So you see in villages and government farms, aged and infertile cows, you know, being accumulated inside the farm. So they don't give any milk, but they eat food, right? They eat food, they make trouble, right? They harbor all kinds of, you know, diseases, right? So they act as a source of infection. They eat the food that the high producing animals could be producing, and more than anything else, you know, they make the data look bad, right? So for example, now if we say, you know, 400,000 divided by 400 million divided by 400,000 gives you the highest number. But if you add these three together, 400,000, 642,000 plus this, which comes to 800,000, right? So that if you add these together, you know, it doubles the cow number. Therefore, it can halve the average production, right? So that is the problem with these cows. If you don't, they are non-productive. They have identified as infertile and aged cows. Right? So there's no point keeping them. Right? So unfortunately, that's the situation in Sri Lanka. Right? I hope that's clear to you. Right. So now you need to know. So when you collect milk, right? So I think you will do this in detail for public health. You may not have done it yet, right? So typically, in large-scale farms like Ambevala Farm, New Zealand Farm, Riddiagama Farm, you know, they have this milking facility which we call a milking parlor, right? And then on the milking parlor, once the milk is milked out of the cows, it directly goes into a chiller. Chilling is cooling milk, right? So the chiller cools the milk, right? Right? Chilling, sorry, give me a second. Chilling is like cooling the milk to 4 degrees. That if you don't cool it, the milk gets spoiled, right? So to avoid that, you need to chill the milk, right? So it will directly go to the chiller, which is inside the farm premises, in large scale farm, right? And from the chiller, it will get into a bowser and it will go to the processing factory. But in small scale, small holder farms, you would have seen small three-wheelers, Piaggio three-wheelers, and even Batto, right? Lorries, small lorries, Batto, Kiri containers, right? So, so that's what happens with small scale farm, right? And so now small scale farm doesn't have their own chiller, right? Chilling center. So what they have to do is there are chilling centers, right? Maintained by the government and private sector, like milk collectors, Nestle, Milko, and so on, right? So they have their chilling center. So, you know, chilling center capacity should be, you know, should be able to handle the milk that is produced, right? So do we have that capacity? So do a calculation and see, right? So we, Sri Lanka produces what, 500 million liters, let's say approximately a year, 482. Divide that by 365, right? So you get like what, 1.3 million, 1.2 million liters a day, right? But look at the chilling capacity. 800,000 liters, right? So what? So these are annual figures, huh? These are annual figures. So even out of that, 480,000, only 284,000 enters the milk collection network, chilling center. So what happens to the other 200,000? Now that will get locally distributed, right? With small scale farmers, and then large scale farmers have their own chillers, right? So I think you need to, I don't know what I mean by what about the other 200 million liters here. Yeah, okay, so 284,000 is what gets collected, and the other 200 million, I just talked about it. Okay, right, I hope it's clear. Right, now, so we produce all this milk. Approximately 500 million liters of milk, 30 million kilograms of beef, so on and so forth. We talked about these numbers during the first lecture. Now, are we self-sufficient? What do you know? Are we self-sufficient in dairy milk? Are we self-sufficient in beef? Right? So, while we produce approximately 500 million liters, 480 something, we import 750 million liters, which is a lot higher than this number. Right? So that gives at a cost of 54 billion rupees in 2018. But in other industries, the import cost is a lot lower. 0.1 billion, it's almost insignificant, right? So this is the major concern right now, right? 54 billion rupees to import that amount of milk. Right? So that is a huge import bill Sri Lanka has to bear. Right now, this 750 million liters, do you think we import this milk as liters? Do we import it as liquid milk? No, so actually we import it as powder, so metric ton, right? So we usually import it as powder. It's not just milk powder, you know, other stuff also, but ghee and different things. But so usually we weigh that in metric tons, right? So this is how many metric tons that was imported in 2017. About 100,000 approximately metric tons, right? And so how do you convert that into liters? So this LME stands for liquid milk equivalent, right? So the liquid equivalent of this metric ton, right? So that's what it means. Liquid equivalent of this metric ton is that, right? Is 7 times higher. So we usually say, how many liters of milk goes into producing 1 kilogram of milk powder? Can 1 liter of milk produce 1 kilogram of milk powder, or you need more? So we usually say you need 8 liters of milk to produce 1 kilogram of powder, right? So this, you see a similar ratio here, 1 to 7, right? So metric ton is, you know, 1,000 kilos. Here they are giving in 1,000 liters also, right? So it's a direct comparison. You can do the real comparison. So thousands of liters, so that's 723 million. On the previous slide I approximated that and said 750 million. The actual number in 2017 was 723 million. Right? So you can see it's slightly more than 7 times. That is because, you know, it's not only milk powder. You know, there are other things also brought, right? So the important thing here is you need to have an idea about how many metric tons do we import, or the liquid milk equivalent of that. Right, so in 2017, that was the cost, the import bill, 54 billion was in 2018. It has gradually gone up. 2013, 14, 15, 16 came down again, went back up in 17. Right, so you need to have a rough idea about these figures, the ones that I have highlighted. That's a 54 billion that was in 2018. Right, now how does this 54 billion, you know, for you and I, 54 billion is a massive amount of money, which we can't even imagine, right? But for a government, is it that big? Right? So I did some research and I found out that for all of higher education, right, this HE for higher education, which is, you know, what you're getting at the university, right? So Peravinaya Colombo, Kattubadda, Ruhuna, all together, Kalaniya, all the universities together, the government only spends spends 50 billion rupees, right? And for milk, it's 54. The total collection of water bills from the National Water Board, Drainage and Water Board or whatever, is half that of the milk importation bill. The three port authorities, right? Colombo, Gaul, Hambantota has not earned any money in 2018, right? What's the other one? Trinco, right? So the income of the three ports had been just 52 billion, and it is not even profit. The total revenue, profit had been something like 7 or 8 billion, but total revenue was 52. You know, we do a lot of construction, we import like, I don't know, half of the cement we want or whatever. And even for all that, just 48 billion. You would have seen all the massive constructions going on in Colombo, the highways, the apartment complex, the hotels, right? In spite of all that, they only spent 48 billion for imports. And this is the medical and pharmaceutical imports. So 21 million people in Sri Lanka, the old people, the aged ones, the deceased ones, you know, we import the majority of the drugs to Sri Lanka. And even for those drugs, we only spend 86 billion, right? And then the total food and drink, right? Importation is also only 5 times that of milk. So this includes everything from dal to rice to, you know, all the imports, sugar. We import a lot sugar also. We are only spending 200, not only, but we are only spending 5 times the milk. Right? So what this tells you is 54 billion is in fact a big deal, right? So it is a big deal. It's not a negligible amount of money even for a government, right? And look at these figures, right? How they have evolved over the years from 2017 to 18. I left these blank so that you can look at the references that I have uploaded and fill these blanks in. See, total consumption has increased over the years from 888 to 1200 million. Local production has also increased, but because total consumption has gone up, imports have also gone up, even though local production increased. And so you need to have a slight idea about these numbers, and these numbers you definitely need to know. And so you have to know these numbers, how much we import, how much we produce locally, and what the total consumption. Roughly you need to know, you know, 1,200 million or 1.2 billion liters total consumption, approximately 500 million produced in Sri Lanka, approximately 750 million liters imported at the cost of this side. So you add these two together, you get 102 billion rupees. And guess what was the cost of the... Right, so fill in the blanks. Yeah, I told you that. Right, so the cost of the highway from Kottava to Gaul was only 115 billion rupees at the time. We spend this money for milk importation in 2 years, approximately 2 to 3 years. Right. So of course, you know, this was done 7-8 years ago, and the dollar rate was lower, right? But however, so it might not be apples and apples comparison, but however, you know, the ballpark figure, we are spending a lot of money on milk importation, right? So that's the bottom line you have to learn here. And if we can become self-sufficient and save Sri Lanka this mammoth amount of money, right? You know, that can be used for development of the country. So that's the bottom line. So you have to self-learn about the different populations of animals. I've already told you that on the first lecture also. So you have to refer the livestock statistical bulletins, DAPH annual reports, statistics.gov.lk, right? Resources on Moodle. So you need to be aware of the annual figure as well as the daily figure, right? So annual figures are these, so 2013 not so much, but 2017-18, you know, how much we consume per year, how much we produce locally, how much we import, and the daily figures, right? So this value divided by 365 gives you this value, right? So you need to know that, you know, we consume this much every day, out of which we produce this much locally every day, and therefore the deficit is what we have to import, right? So you need to know these numbers, right? So you and I are fortunate enough to be veterinarians, and thereby, you know, if we do our job right, we can contribute towards saving Sri Lanka 54 billion rupees. That's a lot of cash, right? So if we can make Sri Lanka self-sufficient in dairy product, that's how much we can save the country every year or more as years go on. And so how do we do that? So for which you need to remember these numbers, right? The ones that I told you about per day, a million liters per day. And there are, you know, basically if you think about it, there are only two ways by which you can do this. Either you have to increase the production of the existing population, or you have to acquire additional high producing animals. So either you increase the daily production of the existing cows, or you import or you locally produce additional cows, which are preferably high producing. Right, so if you look at the current population, remember the current population was something like 650,000 or whatever, right? So this is our total requirement, 3.3 million liters a day. So if we can get 660,000, more precisely 665,000 cows to give 5 liters a day, you know, we can achieve this. So theoretically it looks really easy, because we already have this. We already have this together with the infertile cows. We have 800,000, right? So we have approximately this number of producing cows in production. But unfortunately, remember they averaged at this number. They averaged 1.7 liters. But 5 liters doesn't look like a rocket science, right? So if we can get all our animals to average 5 liters a day, fantastic, we can become self-sufficient within a very short period, right? But this is in theory. Alternatively, right, so these are deficit, that we need to produce 2 million liters a day additionally, right? So to produce that, we need 200,000 cows giving 10 liters per day. So in addition to this, we are already producing 1.3. We want an extra 2 million liters. So if we do that with just 10 liter cows per day production, we need 200,000 animals, new animals, right? If we can have 15 liter cows, we can do that with 133,000 cows. If we can have 20 liter cows, right, we'll need even fewer. You just do the calculation, very simple mathematics, right? So the point I'm trying to show you here is, the increased production of existing population, that's this. So the existing 1.7 liters needs to be upgraded to 5 liters for the whole population. Alternatively, we have to acquire additional cows. So there may be 10 liters, 15 liter or 20 liter potential cows. So the higher the production level, the lower the number of cows we need. So this is all in theory. So theoretically, this is one of the markets. Even practically, we'll have to pick one of these models or a combination of those. Right. So now, before we pick any model, we have to always see, we don't have to invent things, right? Because the world has done it for us, right? So all we have to do is examine what others have done, right? So let's look at the some of the trends from, other countries who are already self-sufficient or even, producing excess and exporting. So this is Canada, Canada from 1981 to 2016. The x-axis shows the number of dairy cows in thousands, right? So this would be 2 million cows, right? So because when you add three more digits, zeros, right? And of course the y-axis, I'm sorry, y-axis here, x-axis you see the years, right? And z-axis here on the right side shows the total milk production, right? So total milk production, right? So from 1980 to 2016, which is 35 years, so milk production has slightly increased, not a lot, right? So from about 7 million kiloliters, right? About 8.5. So more or less constant, slight increase. And so they use a term called kiloliters, which we don't use in Sri Lanka. So that, I suppose that's equivalent to 1,000 liters. Right. But look at this, the number of dairy cows, in spite of maintaining the milk production or even increasing, cow numbers have gone down. How is that possible? Total milk has increased, but cow number has decreased. How is that possible? Okay, so that was Canada. So this is USDA, United States Department of Agriculture. So let's look at some US data. Okay, this shows the cow numbers in millions, right? So in 1940, they have had around 25 million cows, and by 2015 or so, the 25 million came down to about 9 million cows. That's the current US cow population, 9 million dairy cows, right? But let's look at the milk production. Now in Canada, of course, we saw it's more or less constant, right? Wasn't a massive increase, but look at this in the US in the 1940s, so this is this, so earlier Canada, the Canadian chart showed the, country production, right? Country production. But this one shows per cow production, milk per cow. See? So a cow produced per lactation, about 2,500 liters or kilos per lactation back in the 1940s. But by 2015, they are producing as much as 10,000 liters per lactation or per year, right? Now remember I told you in a previous lecture, breed, when we were discussing breed characteristics, that we expect Holstein Friesians to produce about 6,000 liters, which is 6,000 liters is not easy to get because 300 days, 20 liters every day for 300 days, so that's not easy. So I said in Sri Lanka, the typical Holstein Friesian produces maybe 4,000, right? But not as much as this. But in the US, they have improved their animals and they are getting up to 10,000 liter. So even if you divide 10,000 by 365, they are averaging about nearly 30 liters. In the US, they talk in pounds. So if I remember right, they were producing their cows are averaging something like 55 pounds, pounds, something close to, I suppose, 25 liters or so, right? Okay, so we saw that the total milk increased, cow number decreased. However, individual cow yield has increased, right? So over the last 70 years, milk production has quadrupled, not doubled, not tripled, but or tripled, but quadrupled. Hatara that's a massive increase. Okay, so now let's look at again the USDA, US data. Right, so blue line shows cows per farm, right, from 1970s to 2006, cows per farm has increased. Cows per farm in the 1970s, a farm has averaged about 20 animals. But by 2006, the average farm had 120 animals, right? So the farm size has increased. Operations is like home farm, number of farms. But look at the number of farms, in thousands, so 700 would mean 700,000 farms in 1970 versus 100,000 farms by 2016, right? So farm number decreased, however, farm size, cows per farm has increased. So we've talked about we've seen five characteristics of the dairy industry in developed countries over the last few decades. Total milk increase, cow number decrease, cow yield increase, farm number has gone down, however, farm size has increased. Right? So now that was the US and the Canada that we looked at. And these are some other countries, European countries, Australia, New Zealand, so on. So average number of cows per head again means the farm size. See? Farm size has increased. Farm size has got bigger, right? Number of cows per farm. Right? So farm size has increased over the years in all these developed countries. Right? So there are certain countries very slight increase, but New Zealand, Australia, United States, Denmark, the major countries, dairy countries, massive increase. Even in England, it's almost doubled. Cow number, not farm number, cow number. Right? So this shows the farm number. For these countries, changing structure of dairy farms in selected European Union countries and US, right? So 2000 versus 2007. Now earlier we looked at old data, 1940, 1970, but here they are looking at relatively recent data, even within 7 years, 2000 to 2007. See, in the United States, number of operations 30% decrease. Denmark 45% decrease, meaning farm number halved basically. They had 9,000, nearly 10,000 farms, came down to 5,000. Germany 25% reduction, France 30%, 20%. Right, so these are global patterns. On the other side, you see cows per farm has increased 88 to 121, 68 to 107, 35 to 41. So on. So cows per farm increases, meaning farm size increase. And now look at that. Milk per cow. Right? Milk per cow, meaning cow yield per lactation increased 11%. Denmark increased 15%. Germany increased 13%. 13.5, 13%, 22% in Italy, so on, right? So the message is clear, right? Total milk increased, cow number decreased, yield increased, farm number decreased, farm size has increased all over the world. So this chart shows some additional parameters, right? So let's look at the green line, which shows milk production per cow, right? So again, USDA data, right? USDA data, milk production per cow, right? From, so this is a dollar value, right? So this shows costs and production per cow, right? And, so remember I told you it was, you know, per cow production, pounds, in the United States. Right, so these are, you know, from a cost point of view. X-axis shows the size of the farm, size of operation by cow number, you know, as small as 50 animals, 1,000 or more animals, right? So the, what you need to understand here is the larger the farm size, higher the production per cow. Right, because, you know, large farm, obviously, they use better management, techniques. Therefore, milk production goes up, right? And then, look at this. Average total economic cost, right? So, average per animal, or it could be per liter of milk. So, anyway, the average cost comes down. So, the larger the farm, cheaper the production, or lower the cost of production per liter of milk, right? So average total operating cost, right? So production increases, cost of production decreases, right? So we can add one more parameter here in addition to these five characteristics. Cost of production, COP, decreases, right? So again, you know, some other things this shows from, you know, 1950s to 2010, milk production increases, like we said earlier, total milk production that is, and now the milk production per cow has obviously increased, number of cows, according to this has increased, so this is a change relative to, I don't know how to explain this. Right, I don't know how to explain this because the previous one showed, cow number decreasing. Right, so number of dairies decreased definitely and meat, and so these are important parameter here, methane per kilogram of cow, per milk has decreased. So which means pollution has decreased. Right, so this one, I don't know how to explain because on a previous slide, it was clearly shown that in the US, cow number came down from the 1940s. Let's get back to that slide here. See, cow number decreases even from 1950 onwards, right? So I really don't know why this particular chart shows a different value. So because in this, cow number has doubled from 1950 to 2010. That's 100% increase, right? That might be error. Sorry, I can't explain that. Right, so let's move on. Right. So we saw seven characteristics. Cost of milk, total milk production increase, cow number decrease, cow yield increase, farm number decrease, farm size has increased, cost of production has come down, and level of pollution has decreased, right? So all in all, these are the major characteristics of the dairy industry throughout the world over the last few decades, right? With the development of the dairy industry, these were the features that were observed, right? So if we want to become self-sufficient in dairy industry, what should we do? Should we try to come up with a strategy that is totally different to the rest of the world, or should we try to copy a system that has been proven to be successful? What do you think? We can try something that's different and unique, but you know, I would rather follow a proven pathway that has already been successful than try to invent something new, right? So we have kind of tried to do that over the last few decades, but we have not succeeded, as you saw from the figures that I showed, right? So I think the best way to do this would be to follow the successful model to a certain extent, and of course we'll have to do certain modifications to suit our own situation. So you know what we should do. Should we go with smaller farms or larger farms? Should we increase the farm number, or should we, you know, increase the farm size, cow number, what to do? Do we want to increase number of cows, or do we want to have a smaller number of cows but who are higher producing animals, right? So if we do those changes, you know the benefits we are going to get, right? So actually you'll learn those during the next few slides, and we are going to get certain benefits, right? So you know that the current world population is somewhere around 7 billion, right? And we are rapidly going towards 9 billion within the next 2 decades, right? So, so what happens? So you have extra mouths to feed. We are not talking here hundreds of thousands or millions. We are talking about billions, right? So a billion is 1,000 million. Right, so 2 billion means 2,000 million increase. Sri Lanka only has 20 million population, right? So compared to that 20 million, can you imagine how large a size is 2,000 million, right, all over the world? Right, so what happens with these increased number of heads, you know, the land area available for residential purposes as well as for agricultural purposes shrink, right? So there's a term called arable land. You can read what that means. That's a basically fertile land ready to be cultivated for agricultural purposes. So in 1961, taking the global situation, there was 1 acre per person, right? So this is, when you say arable land, it's excluding the, you know, the deserts and glaciers and so on, right? So by 2006, it decreased to 0.55 acres per person. And by 2050, it's expected to come down to 0.4 acres per person, right? So which means with this 0.4 acres, which comes to about 48 purchase, you have to be able to, you know, feed a person. You have to be able to cultivate all the rice, all the corn for bread, the milk, the meat. That's all you have. 50 purchase. With 50 purchase, you have to cultivate everything and feed this person throughout the year. So if you look at the global situation, if you look at the country situation, it's much, much worse for small countries like Sri Lanka. Even Saudi Arabia, with all those deserts, they have more land than us. But Sri Lanka, 0.05 acre. So that's 0.1 is 16 purchase, and 0.05 is 8 purchase per person. That's all you get to build your house, to eat, drink, make babies, for everything. That's all you get, right? So what does this mean for the dairy industry or agriculture? To feed this expanding population, we don't get expanding, you know, land area to cultivate, right? So all we can do is we can increase the production efficiency, right? So increase production efficiency, not only in agricultural products, but also in dairy, poultry, you know, whatever. That's what we need to do, and that's why we are learning all this, right? So why do we have to learn all this, you might ask? You know, I just want to do dairy calf management, teach me calf management, lactating cow management. Why do I have to learn all this BS, you might ask, right? Because you need to know the importance of all this. So in the US, they say for every liter of milk sold, right, it generates an economic activity of $3, right? You don't have data in Sri Lanka, that's why I'm showing you US data. And they say for every $1 million of US milk sales, you generate 17 new jobs, employment opportunities. Right? So US dairy industry is estimated at 140 billion, right? And creates 900,000 jobs. I actually gave you some more recent figures than this. Right? So $200 billion during the first lecture, direct impact. And then I said the indirect impact was 400. So altogether can be valued at 600 billion US dollars. Right? So the important thing is milk doesn't stay on the farm. Where milk goes, jobs follow. Right? So there could be not only the dairy related ones, those who grow and ship feed for the cows, veterinarians, livestock development inspectors in Sri Lanka situation, farm laborers, milk collectors, drivers, you know, you can all read all this. Even insurance agents, accountants, bankers, because people get bank loans. They do account balancing when they want to build a new farm, right? So machinery, grass choppers, you name it, right? All of these are employment opportunities for people. And so eventually, more milk, cheaper milk, malnutrition is a problem in Sri Lanka, I showed you during lecture one. So hopefully, more intelligence, not more intelligent, right now it's zero, so intelligent future politicians who will hopefully dig this country out of the rot it's currently in, right? And you can contribute to that. Right, so some more statistics. In California, they have shown for every 4 cows creates 1 job. Different job opportunities created by the dairy industry. Right. So then the question becomes. Right. So we said, you know, these certain characteristics: farm number, farm size, cow number, cow production. Right, so different farming systems in the whole world, and what is the best system that Sri Lanka should adopt, right? So that's what we intend to look at during the next few slides, right? So there are 3 major dairy farming systems in the world as far as I'm concerned, right? And out of these 3, which one is suitable for Sri Lanka? That's the big question we are going to answer within the next few slides. Okay. These are not very recent data. These are pretty old data. But nevertheless, the overall trend is the same. Right. So these balls, right, blue balls, they show the their size represents level of milk production, not level, actual quantity, right? So you see the biggest bubble around India. That's because they are the largest milk producer in the world, right? So they produce 165 billion liters, right? Billion liters every year. So remember, Sri Lanka produces 500 million. India produces 165 billion liters. USA is the second largest milk producer at 92 billion liters, right? Pakistan number 4, New Zealand number 19.
Right. So now we've seen the highest milk producers, right? So now let's look at the farm numbers, number of farms of these different countries, right? So India, 165 billion, 92 billion USA, 19 billion in New Zealand. Look at the farm number, 76 million farms in India, 51,000 in USA, 13,000 only in New Zealand. Remember Sri Lanka, how many did we have? We had 330,000 farms, huh? So we had 6 times more farms, dairy farms, than the USA. But USA produces 92 billion liters and we produce 500 million. So something doesn't look right. So India produces only 1.8 times more milk than USA, but they have 1,500 more farms than the USA. As you look at the total cow number, similar situation, 15 times more cows, but only 1.8 times more milk. And look at the average cow production, 8 times more production in the US cows. Right? So these are some characteristics to for you to observe and learn from. We want to make Sri Lanka self-sufficient in milk. This is what India, USA, and New Zealand models tell us, right? What should we adopt? Like I said, there are three major farming systems: India, US, and New Zealand, right? The comparisons that I just did. Right, highest producing animals in the USA model, right? And right, so the typical Indian farm. I don't know if it's a typical Indian farm, but most of these farms are like this in India. Right, so cows per farm 1.7, cows per farm. So two cow farms is the average. Right, so not a lot of technology is being used, right? Relatively traditional methods used, and boss indicates cattle. That's the Indian model. US model is obviously different. Sorry. Right. So this is actually New Zealand on the outdoor animals, right? So that's a feature of the New Zealand model farming system, where animals graze freely. There are no large cow barns, right? And the US model is where you have animals inside these massive sheds or structures, cow barns, right? So those are the three main features features, right? So very primitive kind of farming system, very high-tech farming system, you know, cut and fed, intensive, 100% cut and fed. Here, they're not cut and fed, they just come in for milking. Afterwards, they are sent out for grazing, right? So out of these three, so which one is more suitable? Out of the, we compare the New Zealand and US model, I'm afraid the New Zealand model is not suitable to us, right? So New Zealand, you have nice weather, you know, 5 degrees to 15 degrees throughout the year. You know, so the sun is not as strong as here, it's a tropical country, right? And there's plenty of grazing land, right? However, there are some negatives here compared to, you know, the US model, and that is also a reason why it's not suitable for us. I mean, there's high wastage because animals would, you know, step or trample the foragers further and contaminate it with urine and feces, right? So all these causes high wastage, and Sri Lanka cannot afford that because we have limited land and we want to use as much of the harvest as possible, right? So because when you cut and feed, animals don't step on it, animals don't urinate in the field, right? So whatever you cut, you can feed the animal 100%, but they, when they graze, that doesn't happen, right? So that's also something called grazing damage, when you graze too close to the ground, you know, and this can happen, and pasture doesn't grow there, you have to recultivate. And so for these reasons, we have to reject the New Zealand model. It's not suitable to Sri Lanka, which means we have to choose between the US model and the Indian model, right? So, you know, when I made these slides back in 2016, this was our total consumption, but today, you know, it has gone up to about 1,250 million liters. That you need to be familiar with the 2018 stats. So with the Indian model, right, if we are to produce, you know, 3 million liters with cows producing, cows averaging 3.5 liters per day, we would need something like, you know, 850,000 cows. But if we are to adopt the US model to produce 3 million liters a day with 28 liter cows, we need only 107,000 cows, right? So that's, you know, big difference, 100,000 versus 850,000. Or do you think, you know, eventually with 100,000 or 800,000, they are going to produce 3 million liters of milk per day? Do you think the pasture land needed for these two models is the same or different? Right? Same amount of pasture or not to produce 3 million liters, 800,000 cows, Indian model, 100,000 cows, US model. What do you think? So before we go there, think of a cow giving 20 liters of milk a day and a cow giving 5 liters of milk a day. Do you think they eat the same amount? Or do you think cow B eats only one quarter of what cow A eats? When it gives 20 liters, 5 liters, one quarter of the production. But do you think it also is one quarter of the pasture that this guy is? Right, so this is a little beyond what you your level, but I'll just go through it quickly. So we basically say an animal needs energy for four things, right? Maintenance, lactation, pregnancy, and exercise, right? Walking, right? So maintenance is the same amount of energy regardless of, you know, level of milk production. And for milk, it's 5 megajoules per liter. So 5, 1 liter animal would need 5 megajoules, would need to eat 5 megajoules to produce 1 liter. 10 liter animal needs to consume 50 megajoules for milk. So maintenance 60, 50 for milk. So that's 110 altogether. And depending on the month of pregnancy, it may need as much as 20 megajoules, right? So all the details are here. I'm not going to go into detail here because I'll be covering this as we go along in dairy management. But I just want to make one point here, that is, you know, even if it's a non-producing animal or a high-producing animal, this maintenance requirement is the same, right? So let's say a non-producing animal and 2-liter animal, right? Energy consumption is almost the same. So non-producing animal eats a lot, right? But you're not getting any milk out of that animal, right? So going back to the Indian versus US model, right? Indian model was like a 3-liter cow, US model was like a 30-liter cow. I've done all these calculations. You can go through them slowly, right? So 3 liters, 15 megajoules per milk, 10 liters, 50, 20 times 5, 30 times 5, right? So the take-home message here is, for a low-producing cow, for each liter of milk, right, it has to consume more megajoules. See, this guy, although for a liter, it's only 5 megajoules per liter, when you consider the maintenance and all that, see, it costs 27 megajoules per liter here. But high producing cows, see, cost of milk only 7 megajoules per liter. You can go through this slowly and understand this. Eventually, it translates into acres of pasture land, right? 3 liter cows, you need as much as 40,000 acres, right, to produce 1 million liter of milk, 1 million liters of milk. And for the 30 liter cows, you need only 10,000 acres, right? So 1/4 of acreage with high producing cows as versus Indian model, right? So with the exact numbers in India, right, and so these are the numbers we are looking at, right, for you know, to become self-sufficient, right, 100,000 acres basically versus 32,000 acres to produce that 3 million liters per day, right? You can go through the calculation slowly, and so which is suitable for us, you know, I mean, hands down, I have to vote for this option. Because, you know, Sri Lanka is a small country. Even if we have this amount of land, right, it's much easier to maintain 30,000 acres versus 100,000 acres. Right? So, I have to vote for the US model. Extra 70,000 acres. Can't afford. Right? So, this is the model that, you know, I personally believe will drive Sri Lanka towards self-sufficiency, right? Okay, so maybe something like this, maybe 28 liters is too much for national average for a country like Sri Lanka, right? But if we can get 15 liter cows, you know, total of 200,000 animals, that's 3 million liters per day, and that's about 80% of our requirement. Right, so that we can become 80% self-sufficient. We don't have to become almost 100%, right, with 40,000 acres of pasture cultivation. Right now, but you know, it's easy to say that, but then what happens with the, you know, the 300,000 farmers that are already in Sri Lanka? Can we abandon them? We cannot abandon them. You know, we have to stick to these, we have to follow these as much as possible, you know, what the rest of the world has done. But we can't abandon the 300,000 plus smallholder farmers, right? So we have to take that into consideration when we devise a strategy to become self-sufficient, right? So that's what I'm proposing here. So you know, maybe we don't have to become 100% self-sufficient. Out of the 3.5 million requirement, you know, we locally produce 3 million and we maybe import a small amount, 0.5. Right now we are locally producing 1.5 and importing 2 approximately, right? So maybe this is what we want to become. These are goal, right? And we also cannot abandon this.
Big question is, how do we fulfill these yet keep these farmers happy, right? So something, you know, we've been proposing as the faculty together with the Sri Lanka Veterinary Association, you know, and certain experts in the dairy industry like Dr. Veerasingha of the VRI, Dr. K.K. Jagat. You know, you learn about him. He's actually a private practitioner, dairy specialist, right? So what we collectively suggest is, you know, so improve a subset, you know, identify and improve a subset of the existing population to produce a lot of milk, and also upgrade the remainder of the animals to produce a little bit more, so right, than they're already producing, right? So right now the average maybe, let's say, 2 liters, 3 liters, right, 2.8 or whatever is what we got, so let's say 3 liters, upgrade it by, you know, 1/3, make 3 liters 4 liters, right? And then you still have the, so right now they are producing 1.5 million liters, right? Approximately 500,000 cows, let's say, times 3 liters, 1.5. But here, you know, you're separating out 100,000 animals, superior animals, and 400 times 4 liters, again, you're getting something like 1.5 million liters, right? And, but then you get this 100,000 superior animals or elite animals to produce 15 liters a day. That gives you an additional 1.5 million liters and you get your 3 million local production, 0.5 million imports, 3.5 million liters daily consumption. Okay. So this could be existing animals, right, identified elite animals in the existing population, or it could be imported animals also, right? So 100,000 animals giving 15 liters and 400,000 animals giving 4 liters on average, right? So even if we do this, you see it will take us a long time, right? So over the last 5-6 years, from 2012 onwards, you know, the NLDB and the ministry imported like 7,000 cows, right, from New Zealand and Australia. And Sri Lanka struggled a lot to make that successful. You know, feeding 7,000 or 5,000 new cattle is no easy task, right? But now for us to, you know, manage these 100,000 animals, right, 15 liter cows, it's going to be multiple times more difficult than with the, you know, compared to the 5,000 cows that we imported, right? So let's say even if we introduce just 20,000 animals per year, it's going to take us, let's say we introduce 10,000 animals per year, because we couldn't, over the last 5 years, we couldn't even manage 5,000 over 5 years, right? So to manage 10,000 animals per year would be a massive challenge by itself. So if we add 10,000 new animals per year, In 2 years, 20,000. By 24, 40, 60, 80, 100,000. But even then, even if we start now, it will be 2030 when we reach that goal. Right, so 20,000 animals would give you additional, 300,000 liters. 40,000 animals, additional 600,000 liters. And eventually, if you when you hit 100,000 animals, you are getting that 1.5 million liters per day, right? That is with 15 liter cows. But if we could upgrade this to 20 liters, we can reduce the number of animals. Instead of 100,000 animals, we can do that with 75,000 animals. Either way, it's not going to be an easy task, right? That's the point I wanted to tell you. You can't achieve self-sufficiency in 2 years. You might see a politician coming up and saying, by 2022 we'll become self-sufficient. He has no idea about this calculation, right? So like I said, we can breed these animals locally, or we'll have to import, and not all at once, but in different stages, right? And so then our current production will gradually go up from here to self-sufficiency, right? So what we say is, 10,000 new cows added every year. So that's 150,000 cows, milk, liters of milk per day added every year, right? And within 6, 7 years or 10 years, we might be able to achieve this goal. Because you see, these 10,000 cows, they will also produce calves, right? So even if you add, 60,000 over 3 years, 6 years, so that 60,000 will have calved about, 20,000 at least female animals. If you use, if you use female semen, there's something called female semen, sex sorted semen. 60,000 animals will potentially calve, give 60,000 female animals, right? Or even more, because some animals would have gone through multiple parities. But those are details. I'm just giving you a rough model, right? So this is my plan of making Sri Lanka self-sufficient, right? So to summarize again, 80% of the population, of about 400,000 of the local population, will give produce 4 liters each. And we identify a subpopulation, right? Maybe around 100,000, that have the capacity to produce 15 to 20 liters, right? And we'll also have to identify some elite animals, right? High genetic potential as donor animals. And then, we can get their ova, and transfer to recipient cows or surrogate cows, some advanced reproductive technologies. You can learn about those. You'll learn about those, as we go along. So just to summarize, this is what this is. This should be the plan to make Sri Lanka self-sufficient, right? As far as I'm concerned, this is the only way. Okay, so that's all. This is a long lecture today. I hope you were able to answer all the questions on the pre-test, right? Thank you very much.